Giant Voice.
The official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
Okay, everybody. On this episode of the Giant Voice Podcast, I am not usually intimidated, but I am here with a bunch of very smart people who are much smarter than me, a bunch of doctors and mental health professionals. So I am a little bit intimidated, but I think it's going to be okay. We are here to talk a bit about helping military families prepare and deal with the upcoming Homeport shift from a mental health perspective. So, like I said, a lot of very smart people in the room with me. We're going to go around the room and do a little introductions. Let's start right to my left here.
Hi, good morning. I'm Lieutenant Commander Allison Conforte. I am a clinical psychologist who works with children and adolescents here in our EDIS department with the hospital. So that's the Educational Developmental Intervention Services. And I work a lot with kids at the school system here.
Cool.
Good morning. I am HM2 Coleman. First name is Chayla. I work in the mental health clinic at USNMRTC Yokosuka Hospital. I've worked in the mental health clinic and our SARP clinic, which is our drug and alcohol clinic as well.
Excellent.
Good morning. I'm Lieutenant Paige Giegel. I'm a physical therapist, and I also work in the EDIS department. I work mostly with kids who are 0 to 3 years old, and then also help out in the elementary school with kids who need help with their physical abilities. But being a part of EDIS has introduced me to a lot of new things about mental health. I also have a history of being a military kid. I've gone through a number of Homeport shifts myself.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so hoping to bring a little insight from what I went through as a kid and things that were hard and things that helped.
Excellent.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Michelle McDonald. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist who specializes in pediatrics. I'm also part of the EDIS team here. I have a long history working with kiddos both in the school systems and in private practice or private settings. So I'm just really passionate about talking about kids' mental health needs.
Excellent. It sounds like I was right, and we have a lot of very well-educated, well-informed people. On the podcast, we've been talking a lot about the Homeport shift. We've been providing a lot of sort of material information, one could say, you know, kind of like how to get your car registered when you get here and how to get a passport and all of the things that people who are coming to Japan for the first time might need to know. I think this is a little bit of a different set of information, but equally important, if not more important, right? The military in general has some mental health challenges. Living overseas has its own set of mental health challenges. And obviously a major Homeport shift has a set of mental health challenges. And that feels like a lot of things stacked on top of one another, right? So that's why you guys are here. So we're going to start with Lieutenant Commander. Why don't you talk to us about, why you guys are here, and let's talk a little bit about what is a Homeport shift and so on and so forth.
Absolutely. And our team here today, as you were introducing us, I think you highlighted that we're a diverse team of professionals. So we all support the hospital, but we represent different departments. Some of us are here from EDIS, so we do a lot with supporting children, providing early intervention for those kiddos 0 to 3, and then related services and evaluations for our school age population, which starts at 3 and then goes up to 21. And so we're really happy to be here because there are a lot of things to consider when we're talking about a Homeport shift. To consider, you know, children's developmental stages and how we can help families prepare the best based on their family's composition. So there's some general things that we can help support, and then maybe some more specific things that we're hoping that will be valuable. And then we have our mental health and SARP representative here as well, because obviously, as you mentioned, there is a very big overlap between mental health and stress and other psychological factors that go into that we should consider when we're talking about a home port shift and helping families really prepare for that in the best way possible. I think our
resident military child.
Yeah, our resident military child or
is that
children.
Part of your official title?
Yes.
Or children, actually, because we have HM2 Coleman, and they can kind of talk a little bit about their experience and why what's special and unique about the home port shift.
I think that's a great idea, especially people who might have a child who are doing the home port shift. They've never done it. They don't know what their child is, how their child is going to perceive this experience, right? So maybe you guys can shed some light. So walk me through what the experience was like.
Yeah, sure. So as a military child, now active duty military myself, I've done 12 PCSs.
Yikes.
Some overseas, some within the States. And the ones that were not home port shifts had a lot of different supports than when you do a home port shift. So when I was in middle school, we moved from D.C. to Lemoore, California. But my dad's unit was in Atsugi. They shifted back to Lemoore 4 months after we moved to Lemoore. But that meant that my dad went to Japan and we went to California. Whereas most of the time with the PCSs, we all went together.
Ah, yeah, I know this type of thing. He was came as like a geo bachelor or something.
So because his orders were so close to the home port shift, he had no other choice.
Gotcha.
And so that's happening here too, where families are being assigned to the Reagan or being assigned to the George Washington, and some of them are not allowed to move with their service member right away.
Right, until the shift actually has completed.
Right, right. And so that's a little different because all of our PCSs, aside from the home port shifts, my dad was there to pack the truck and drive the U-Haul across the country and, you know, help us get settled in our new location. But when we home port shifted, that was a much more limited, you know, ability for him. He was only there for a week or two.
That's hard.
And so it was just very different for our family getting settled in a new place when we didn't have my dad around to help. So
interesting. It's hard.
Yeah. And then the other part of it too is normally when you're PCSing, it's like one at a time. I think a lot of us have that experience where you see someone new come to your unit, a couple people leave from your unit. There are times of the year where more people move and times of the year where fewer people move. But when you do a home port shift, it's this mass PCS.
Yes.
And the resources that are available for you at your detaching command and at your receiving command can be really overwhelmed when you have, I mean, if we're talking about an aircraft carrier.
100%.
Thousands of families moving all at one time. And so I think that was also hard when, you know, registering for school when there are
another 300 kids who need to also register for school.
Right, right, exactly. So I just remember those things being kind of a challenge for our family. It just made, you know, even though we've done 12 PCSs, my dad was a military kid himself. He's probably in the like 30s at this point.
Right.
PCSs, these stand out as being particularly difficult because the resources we would expect really weren't as available.
Right.
So, and then it's also hard not having your military service parent there during this huge time of change.
Yeah, that in and of itself is very difficult because for any spouse who is non-military and never has been military, like navigating the bureaucracy of the Navy is its own kind of, you know, monstrous challenge sometimes if you don't know those things. So,
Yeah, and HM2 and I had been talking about moving when there aren't as many military resources available. And she was telling me some stories about when her dad went on recruiting duty and how they moved somewhere that didn't have a lot of military resources. So wanted to kind of see if you wanted to share that.
Yeah, let's hear some of your experience, HM2.
So I'm a little bit of a unicorn. I'm actually a Army brat.
In that you're magical?
I am magical. Mental health is magical.
I can attest to the fact that she is magical.
Oh, okay.
For real. For real.
Thank you, ma'am. But I am a Army brat. So I have a different perspective on things. Right. So I'm an Army bat that turned into a Navy service member. So my dad calls me a squid.
Of course he does.
And from my perspective, my dad, I believe, he went on deployment 7 or 8 times of my life. So most of my childhood, he wasn't there. My mom was the go-to person. She was the support. She was the disciplinary. She was the one making sure me and my brother, because me and my brother are 10 years apart, making sure that we were going to gymnastics or football, kind of like being that ex. She was being both parents, right? So not seeing my dad a lot affected me as a military child, because I was just used to him not really being there. So when he was home, it was just like, oh, you're here.
Yeah, it was almost weirder to have him home maybe than to not.
Yes, because I would see my mom all the time in those roles. So when he was there, even he would feel somewhat out of place, right? Or try to relearn how to reintegrate with our family. And with my dad going into recruiting, we were actually in Killeen, Texas. And we got the call in the middle of being there that we had just got there. I just started middle school. And it was like, actually, we need you in New York for recruiting, which is a big shift. I have spent most of my time in Texas. I am a Texas girl. I claim it. So when they were saying we're moving to New York, it was just like this huge culture shift.
Wow.
When we got there, come to find out, we couldn't find anywhere in New York to live. So we actually had to move to New Jersey. My dad had
to commute. Jersey City or?
Yes.
Yeah. So, I'm from this neck of the woods. So.
We lived in, Newark, New Jersey?
Oh, God, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So he would have to commute a lot of the time, or he would just stay in New York because it would just be easier. And living in New Jersey, there's not a lot of military people there or resources.
Nope.
So it was kind of hard trying to find someone who related or kind of understand, because usually as a military kid, it's hard because a lot of times when we move, everyone usually in that state or city has their cliques, or they have their community, or they have family that they've grown up with for years. I've never had that experience.
Yep.
I'm always the new kid, new kid on the block all the time. So when we got there, I had to relearn a lot of things. And Texas education is different from New Jersey education. So sometimes as a military kid, you might be behind in the education system or ahead of other kids.
Right.
So even trying to navigate that can be difficult, as well as watching my mom be that military spouse and also try to find her community and find other dependents that can help her relate and integrate into this new culture, this new thing that we just entered. So it was really interesting to see. I believe it made me stronger as a person. I believe that it made me this chameleon. I think military kids, that's like our superpower. We are a chameleon. We are able to adapt to a lot of situations because we had to. We didn't really have a choice. So I think that now as I'm older and being in the military myself, that's actually why I joined the Navy, because I was like, I've been doing this all my life. Might as well continue. It was like an easy transition for me. So I think being a military kid and going through Homeport shifts or PCSing, it's difficult, but it's a hidden superpower that kids and family members can use.
It's resiliency, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah,
totally. So why don't we talk about some things that people can do to prepare for the Homeport shift? Like maybe you guys wanted to talk about, you know, what you can say to your child about the changes that are coming with a Homeport shift.
Yeah, and as I think we've kind of highlighted so far, there's lots of changes going on. Some of them are similar to changes that you might expect during, you know, a routine PCS. And then there's other changes where they're unique. So maybe you, as a parent, you haven't had the opportunity or haven't had this experience, and maybe you don't know what to say or how to even talk about it. And I think the one of the most important things to consider when you're planning for that is really the most important thing is that you do talk to them about it
of course.
That you are talking about the change. So what you say, that's a secondary thing. And, you know, we have some specific suggestions on that as well. But really, being able to have that conversation with your child, and it's an ongoing conversation too. So leaving space and really expecting that as a parent, you know, you're being clear and communicating about it, But then also, you know, there might be other opportunities to come back and revisit topics. There always are those other opportunities.
Sure.
Yeah. So as a parent, you don't have to, you're not expected to know all the answers. You're not expected to know what is right to say. So I think that's a really important thing to keep in mind. And the specifics, I think it really, where your child is developmentally. So you're obviously going to talk to a 3-year-old differently than a 13-year-old or 16-year-old.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
That plays a bit of a role. And then also, you know, as parents, you know, parents know their kids the best. So I think that's always, you know, as we're making any of these recommendations, something for parents to keep in mind is that you know your kid best. So maybe some of the things that we might recommend, they might really fit for you and they might be helpful. And then other things, you know, might not work for your family, and you don't have to do those things. When we're talking about having that conversation, I think we're at a point in time where maybe conversations have already started.
Of course, yeah.
And like I said, this is an ongoing conversation, so that's okay if you've already started the conversation and you hear some things today and you want to revisit that topic. That is completely, you know, would be expected and maybe even helpful. And in general, when we're talking to kids about change, especially in a Homeport shift, it's important to be mindful of our own personal thoughts and feelings about the change. So that can come across a lot when you're talking to the kid.
Kids pick up on your emotional kind of, I know this is like a kind of a goofy word, but like kind of your emotional resonance, right? Like kids kind of like really sense that, don't they? It's crazy. Yeah.
Well, and I think all people do, right?
Yeah, maybe it's just, yeah, all people do, but adults are better at hiding.
Yeah. No. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Kids and, you know, kids look to parents as that source of stability.
Right.
And as that person who, you know, maybe you don't have all the things in control, which we never do, but, you know, have that sense that the parent is the person who, you know.
Some kind of stability.
Yeah. And I think, so going into a conversation with your kids, it's okay to have those feelings, and I think it actually can be really helpful to model resilience, like you had talked about, in sharing, you know, along the way, your own personal feelings. Like, yeah, I'm feeling really stressed about this too, and kind of thinking out loud of saying, I'm feeling really stressed about this, and I'm also looking forward to this, you know, this new job opportunity I have, or I'm looking forward to, oh, the place that we're moving has really great, I don't know, spaghetti or whatever they're known for,
yeah,
right?
You like anime. We're moving to the country where anime's from.
Yeah.
You know, yeah.
And not necessarily telling your kid that they need to think that way, but kind of thinking out loud and modeling it, like, this is how I'm approaching the change.
Interesting.
And then if you're having really strong feelings as a parent, I think it's important to be aware of that as well, that, you know, it's also can be helpful to have another person to talk to.
Yep.
So where you're not just talking to the kids about all of your concerns, but you have an outlet so that when you do talk to your kids, you can come at it with more of a
100%.
Yeah. And I think another interesting and relevant fact is there's been a lot of research into how military children are adjusting to just stressors in general. And I know Dr. McDonald's going to talk a little bit about that. But I think one important thing to think about is that some of that research shows that the children's adjustment, you can kind of predict how well a child is going to adjust to a change or to stressors, based on how their parent is adjusting to that. So again, that is not to say that every parent has to have everything together and they have to be doing great. And if you're not, then your kid's going to do terribly. But it just, you know, want to foot stomp the idea that it's important to take care of yourself, because then that also helps you take care of your kids and then helps them to do better in these situations.
Right. Interesting. Dr. McDonald?
Yeah. So I'm so happy to be here talking about this issue with all of you today. You know, I wanted to share a little bit a personal information to get started,
sure.
Which is just one of the reasons that I'm so passionate about this topic. I am a Navy spouse. So first and foremost, I've gone through some of these changes just myself as a spouse in the military. The other thing is I am a mom, so I have three awesome military-connected kids. So I've also been through some of this stuff with the children, the small little humans in my home. And then the last piece, of course, is I'm a clinician. So I've gone through some of this stuff with other folks' kids. So I really feel like I've had the opportunity to see some of this stuff actually, you know, in action from varying perspectives. So certainly it's one of the reasons I'm so passionate about talking about this and so happy to be here together with all of you today. So I wanted to, of course, talk about how we see our military-connected kids adjusting to change, what we know about how resilient our military kids are, and what adjustment actually looks like for our military-connected kids. So first, let's just start with the big statistic that right now we have approximately 1.55 million military-connected kids in our armed services. So that's pretty awesome. That's a pretty big number, if you ask me. That's a lot of humans who are affected by some of the really unique challenges that military-connected kids face. You know, and recently I went to this training put on by the armed services talking about all this really great research about military-connected kids. And one of the biggest takeaways I took from that training was, you know, our military-connected kids, they experience the same issues, the same behavioral concerns, the same mental health challenges that all kids face at some point in their childhood. But interestingly, our military-connected kids have those at lower prevalence rates than the average population. Yeah. So our military kids are really awesome because just in general, our kids have this broad worldview. They are really flexible, adaptive humans. Really, they turn out to be highly resilient people. And that is a really cool thing. But it isn't in isolation, right? So one of the reasons that our military kids fare so well and they have these lower prevalence rates and they're really resilient is because they're surrounded by all of these resources, such as just this very podcast that the military offers to support our families and support our kids.
That it's sort of maybe a non-military child might have a higher bar to access, say, mental health or you know, any of the services that you guys would provide.
Yes.
I see. That's really interesting.
It's embedded in the system. And just like what we're doing today, we're educating folks, right? Our military community is really well-versed on the deployment phases and stages and what those look like and really what those feel like, right? Because the vast majority of us have been through a lot of that already. So they have a lot of knowledge, experience, and education about what this might feel like and look like and what it might feel like and look like in their kiddos and how to support them, where the resources are to pull in and protect our military kids. So awesome, awesome job to our whole community for putting those things in place, certainly. So, you know, we know that already embedded in our community, we have these fantastic resources and they're really working for our kids. We know that already. But one of the other things that we know about military-connected kids and the reason they can be so resilient is because the well-being of our kiddos is really reflective and dependent on the well-being of our caregivers. So we heard Dr. Conforte talking earlier about families and about taking care of ourselves as caregivers and making sure that we understand our own feelings and we're processing those so that we're talking to our kids in a way that's really helpful and isn't kind of leaking our feelings onto them, right? Projecting, if you might. So the well-being of our families really is important for the well-being of our kids. One of the things that research has shared with us is that we know that there are these 9 traits of really effective, resilient, highly functioning families that that result in positive adjustment outcomes for our families and positive adjustment outcomes for our military-connected kiddos. So I want to talk about those a little bit, if that works. Okay. And I promise, I'm a highly loquacious person. I am very talkative. I'm going to try to.
Don't worry, we're on the same vibe, me and you. Like,
it's the New York thing. It's the New York thing.
I walked in to film a video the other day somewhere, right? And I walked in, and I'm like, hey, I'm here, and I'm going to film this video, everyone's kind of looking at me silently. And it takes a second, and someone's like, they're thrown off by your energy, man. Like, you're coming in here at 100.
Well, they should bring it up, right?
Yeah, dial up, match
me, dial up.
Let's go. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
All right. So these 9 characteristics that we know really resilient families embody. I'm going to talk about these one by one. So the first one, our really resilient families tend to find meaning in adversity. So it doesn't mean that you have to Pollyanna the whole thing, right, and only talk about the positive. But it means our families can look at something and say, this is a challenge, but we're going to pull together, we're going to be in this together, and we're going to do it together, and they find meaning or purpose in that adversity together as a family unit.
Got it.
So that's the first really important piece. The next piece, we could all kind of guess at it a little bit. Certainly, it's that positive outlook. So when our families are able to look at some positive things, Dr. Conforte was talking earlier about paying attention to, yes, things that are difficult, but also the things that we're looking forward to that are going to be exciting and cool about the new place that we're going or this whole experience in general, when we're able to pay attention to that positive outlook, we know that boosts resiliency. The next one is kind of interesting, and I actually talk to folks about this a lot in mental health. So they coined it transcendence and spirituality. I just kind of frame that as faith. In whatever it is that you believe in, what your family culture or values are, it really doesn't matter. We know that resilient families tend to have this faith that they all kind of pull in together around, and it builds this almost protective factor. It provides hope. It provides meaning. It really brings that positive meaning back to the family structure.
Something sort of bigger than yourself,
exactly.
Whatever that might be.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
Got it.
We know resilient families are super flexible. They tend to adapt to change well. And I think that goes back to what Dr. Giegel and HM2 Coleman were talking about earlier, about using those resources that we have at our fingertips to help us field that and navigate that change. Our resilient families, they tend to pull together during times of crisis. They have a high level of connectedness. So we don't see them kind of going off and doing their own thing. We see them pulling in and really adhering to that family unit. The other piece here, and this is kind of an interesting piece, I thought, our resilient families tend to capitalize on all of the social and economic resources that are available to them in the community. Mm. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to be the most extroverted human on the planet, right? And it doesn't mean that you have to be wealthy in order to be able to be a resilient family. It just means that you have to understand your social nature and pull in those resources in the way that fits for you and your family best. Maybe it's in your church community, maybe it's in the spouse's community, maybe it's in the school community, wherever it lies for your family, pulling in those social resources helps, and the economic resources certainly that are available to our military families, excuse me, within this community. Open emotional sharing is another piece of resiliency that our families tend to lean into. Dr. Conforte talked about how parents modeling their emotional experience can be really helpful for kids. We know our resilient families do that. And resilient families tend to present with clarity when they're talking about what's happening in the family. Open communication can be extremely important. And of course, Dr. Conforte mentioned for us earlier, we do that at a developmentally or in a developmentally appropriate way for whoever, however, whatever age the children in our family are. But making sure we're talking openly about this experience and not kind of avoiding the topic or even worst case scenario, fabricating information about what this experience might be like.
That doesn't do anybody any good, does it?
No, sir. You know, and we can talk about this in a little bit, too, but specifically for our middle school age children, they have gained inductive and deductive reasoning.
Oh, yeah.
And when they don't understand something, they tend to fill in the gaps with fiction. They tend to create information to fill in there. So the more our families are using clear, concise, open communication, the less room there is for those kind of pre-adolescent brains to misinterpret and fill in the gaps with fiction. The last piece, number 9, I told you I could be loquacious, but I think I did this.
You're doing great.
I think I did this efficiently.
Yeah.
The last piece of our resilient families, we know that they tend to celebrate a collaborative problem-solving model. And again, we're going to do that developmentally, right? But one of the age groups that tends to do this really well is our adolescent population. They want to be part of figuring out how to make things feel better and solve the problem. So pulling in that collaborative problem-solving approach with our kids can really help to boost the resiliency and protect our kids as we navigate this change and watch our children go through adjustment.
So what you're saying on the last one there, and you can go in one sec too, but you're basically saying that, like, by the time they're getting into early adolescence, they want to help solve problems. And so is that am I misunderstanding that, or is that about right?
Yes, and I think it gives our adolescents and teens a sense of control that maybe, you know, we all like to have a sense of control of something,
right,
especially when things are changing. And so when we're talking to our kids about the upcoming Homeport shift and about change and navigating these things, there's this fine line that we walk of we want to be transparent and we want to involve them. And we also want to be mindful that we're involving them in a way that is developmentally appropriate. So when Dr. McDonald's mentioning this, you know, we're talking about developmental appropriate problem solving for
of
the
course.
Family.
Right.
So, you know, thinking about our military kids, especially living on a military base, and I also have kids that live on base, you know, we tend to give our kids a little bit more responsibility just in general, and a little bit more freedom to do things. And so I think it's one, they have that, we've kind of primed them to be a part of the family in that way. But then also we have to kind of be careful that we're giving them, that we're still as the parent, that we have that sense of, you know, things are in control and we're not asking them to solve problems that they have no control over the pieces to the problem solving.
Or they don't have the capacity to solve. You're not turning them into the parent.
Correct.
You're giving them something age appropriate, right?
Yes, exactly. So maybe that's like, all right, I'm the parent and I have to go down to arrange our housing transfer, you know, as the teenager, what do you think, you know, you and your, you know, 10-year-old brother, how could you best spend this time to help prepare? Are there things that you should be packing? Like getting their input and giving them choices and then also giving them a role to play can be really helpful.
Cool. Yeah, it sounds perfect. I'm just like everything you guys are saying, I'm like equating to my own parenting experiences, you know?
Yeah.
And just thinking about like, do I do that? Yeah.
It's making me reflect on things that happened as a kid too.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I remember moving in middle school, so that like pre-adolescent, adolescent age, and I'd been homeschooled and my mom really let me have a voice in where I went to school and what kind of school that looked like. She, you know,
cool.
I was 13, so I had a brain that worked and had things to think about.
For sure.
And she presented some options that were, you know, I wasn't picking from, I didn't have to go research it or figure it out myself, but she said, hey, do you want to try public middle school for a month or two? We moved during spring break, so we had like a month and a half of school left. Do you want to keep being homeschooled? Like what part of this do you want to have a role in? And I realized that she was really helping me be involved in that problem solving.
That's awesome.
That's amazing, yeah. So let's talk a little bit then about kind of what you expect during a shift or before, after, like what is normal behavior that you're going to see from a child? Obviously, there's going to be some kind of distress or something, right? So what's in the realm of normal, and then when do we cross into something that maybe needs some more support?
Yeah, excellent question. So we've been talking so much about resiliency, and I think this is an important thing for parents to keep in mind. How is my child behaving, and what does this mean about how they're adjusting to this change, how resilient they're being throughout this process? So let's talk about what we know about what adjustment looks like for our military-connected kiddos during a deployment phase. Because I think as we heard Lieutenant Geigel talking about earlier, HM2 Coleman talking about earlier, a lot of times Homeport shift can include some of the pieces of deployment challenges or some of the challenges that families face when they go through deployment. So let's look at what behavior looks like in kids when they're adjusting during a deployment phase. So the first thing I want to lead with is one of the things we know about our kiddos is that typically these changes in behavior are temporary. So the research tells us really within about 2 to 3 weeks, I would maybe expand that a little bit, 3 to 5 weeks, after the initiation of deployment, so after the parent leaves or after this change is initiated, these are the changes we tend to see. And then after that period of time, they start to dissipate. Now, in the field of mental health, in the field of psychology, we watch for the 3-month mark. So between the initiation of the change and about 3 months, these are the behaviors that we might see really uptick, especially between that 3 to 5 week mark, and then slowly start to dissipate back off. Okay. And let's talk about it in a developmentally appropriate frame, because what that adjustment looks like for our little tiny ones who can't even talk is going to be very different than what that adjustment looks like for our big ones who are grown and really moving into that independent space. So let's start with even our infants, because sometimes we see changes in our infants when a caregiver leaves.
Really?
Certainly, yes. They understand what their environment is and who their caregivers are. Infants are really perceptive, and they know who the people are in their environment. So let's talk about what we might see from them, because even an infant, we can see some signs of change or adjustment. With our teensy-tiny ones, really the biggest thing we look at is change in eating habits. And any parent who has taken a tiny one to the CDC or to a new daycare or a new caregiver can tell you,
yes.
We get some adjustment. We call it protest, right, from our little tiny ones. And the very biggest thing that they can control is when and how much and what they eat.
Isn't it so scary the first time that happened?
Yeah, certainly.
We brought him to the doctor. We were like, he doesn't want to eat anything.
Yep.
And his Japanese doctor was like, just wait.
Yep.
It'll be fine.
Yeah. And that's hard for a parent, though,
yeah.
Right? Yes, it's very hard. I certainly sympathize. But that's certainly something that we look at. We say this is a normal part of the adjustment process. If you see it, it should certainly dissipate. And we definitely don't want them not eating for 3 months,
right?
But certainly a little bit of time, we want to see that dissipating and see them adjusting. Now, with our preschoolers, this is an area where we tend to see more external behavior, right? So our little ones, they may actually just look externally sad, express sadness. We may see changing in eating. And we call them elimination habits, right? Toileting habits. Sometimes we get a little bit of regression.
Right.
So if we have a preschooler who's already potty trained, sometimes during adjustment, there's a little regression in those potty training skills, and that can be very normal. We do sometimes see some signs of separation anxiety with the primary caregiver who's still in the environment. And sometimes with our preschoolers who are able to communicate, who have those really robust language skills, sometimes they share confusion, misunderstanding, sometimes even feelings of guilt about where this parent went or why we've moved or why this big change, and does it have something to do with how something I've done.
Right.
Really, though, when we look at the big average summary for preschoolers, a lot of that internal experience comes out as behavior. So we tend to see more tantruming behavior. Really, they can't certainly understand their emotions, and they certainly can't express them as well as some of our older children, so they express it in behavior. Now, when we get up into the school-aged years, it is very normal that some of our school-aged children will have a little bit of academic change. They might change some of their study skills, their homework habits. Maybe some of their grades will falter. Typically, this is temporary, as we talked about before. Sometimes we see some somatic complaints. And just to make sure we're all talking about the same thing, when we say somatic complaints, that's when our kids come to us and they say, oh gosh, I have a tummy ache, I have a headache, I don't feel good, I can't go to school today. They're not sick, there's no virus or any sort of illness underlying these symptoms, but it's truly an emotional experience that's causing them to
It's all connected in there.
That's right, these
yep.
physiological responses. So sometimes we have those somatic complaints, sometimes we have mood changes. With some personalities, we can see a little bit of aggression or defiance in the school-aged population. And again, we're going to talk a little bit about how to handle that as parents. But, you know, staying steady, staying the course with those kiddos, knowing this change is temporary can be helpful. Okay, the last group we're going to talk about as to what change can look like is our adolescents. Our adolescents are really cool humans coming into independence, but certainly these adjustments, these changes can have a big impact on them as well. For some of our kiddos, we can see a little bit of withdrawal. Sometimes that looks like aloof behavior. Or they just kind of pull back a little bit, maybe just don't seem like themselves. Whereas for other adolescents, we can have some acting out behavior, maybe an increase in irritation, an increase in some what we consider safe aggression, right? Nobody's being harmed or hurt, but a little bit of aggression coming out is not something that's atypical. Sometimes some of our teens lose interest in some of the things that they enjoyed previously. And as long as that is short term,
right,
we see that as adjustment and we say that's okay, okay? So these are some of the things that we see are normal adjustment signs and symptoms for our military-connected kids during a deployment phase. How we know then, or how do we know, I guess is the question, is your question. How do we know when our kids—
Something a little bit more.
Yeah, when it's something more, when that adjustment is not going well and we really need to pull in some more of those resources or make a change for our kiddos to help them with this adjustment. So just like we gave that marker before, really watching how long are these symptoms lasting for, that 3-month mark is really important. When we see these things continuing or exacerbating past that mark, that's really a sign for us as parents that we need to pull in some of these resources and intervene for our kiddos.
So, knowing what we know about like what kind of behaviors might be expected, and then what are some of the things that might need a little bit of extra help or a little bit of extra resources, right? How does knowing those outcomes, how does that sort of inform, you know, how we prepare our children for this type of event?
Yeah, absolutely. So some of the things that Dr. McDonald mentioned in regard to what we might expect for the developmental stage really does tie into how we want to communicate with the parents about the change and help our family plan for that change. So for example, you know, she brought up a very good point about adolescents kind of filling in the gaps. And I think we all kind of do this to some degree. If we don't have all the information, our brains try to fill in the puzzles for us.
Yeah, and people see Elvis in their piece of toast.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Yeah. And sometimes, you know, that especially, you know, during adolescence where the world just developmentally, it's normal that the world revolves around me, that then we start to fill in those pieces with, oh, I must have done something wrong. So I think when you're talking about kids about the change, really giving them an understanding of the big picture, the why, as Dr. McDonald mentioned. So sharing kind of the larger picture. So we are doing, this is what our move is going to look like. There's different parts of this move. We might, you know, dad or mom might be leaving for this period of time. And it's because he or she, you know, it's important for them to be at this certain place to do whatever with the command. Like I'm being very vague, but you kind of get the
vibe you're saying. Basically, like, right, there's a thing of like, most conspiracy theories come from the fact that people have large gaps in knowledge, right? Mm-hmm. And they sort of fill in this stuff because they don't know what's supposed to go in that piece. And as humans, like, we have this obsession to want to do that, right? So I guess what you're saying is, if you give them as much information, I mean, you maybe not want to give them everything, mm-hmm, right? But if you give them as much information as sort of you can, maybe you mitigate some of these less desirable outcomes, let's say, mm-hmm, right?
Yeah, and I think, you know, that's a really good point. You don't want to give them too much information. It depends on their age. And then also expecting that, you know, you might have that conversation and maybe some parts of it land, but as the process continues, as you continue to work through the home port shift, that, you know, your kids will likely have questions that come up. And maybe you had talked about it before, but it didn't necessarily land or mean as much to them based at that moment in time. So just allowing space for your child to continue to ask questions. And then when they do, providing kind of that big picture of what's going on.
I see.
Totally. No, I think that's really important, and I wanted to jump in on that because I think that that point is excellent. And one of the things we know as mental health providers, right, is that psychoeducation is really key. And so even sometimes with our kiddos, being able to to pull back the curtain a little bit and recognize, hey, I've noticed that recently you've been biting your fingernails a little bit more. Did you know that biting your fingernails can be a sign of anxiety? Is that how you're feeling? Are you feeling anxious? Feeling anxious during this process is totally normal. And here's some things we can do about it. Sometimes with our kiddos, they experience these changes internally, how they're feeling inside, or externally, how they're behaving. And they can see it to some degree, but they don't always understand why or where it's coming from. So sometimes if we can talk with them in that way and couch that understanding in, this is part of the process and it's normal and we're going to do some things about it and keep an eye on it, everything's going to be okay. Knowing that we're in charge and we get it and we see it and we're going to help them through it can be really helpful for our kiddos.
And I think an important piece to what Dr. McDonald is saying there as well is that you're asking the question of, is that how you're feeling? So we're not making assumptions that your child is feeling that way, and we're giving them space. So it's a conversation. We're not talking at them about the change. We are talking with them about it. And so, as the parent, you're leading that conversation, but you're asking, you know, is my guess about how you're feeling, is that right?
Right. It's a conversation, not a lecture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Interesting. Do either of you guys, HM2 or Lieutenant, do you have any anecdotes about anything, feeling certain ways or any type of behavioral change? Maybe when you were kids, do you remember anything like that?
Absolutely.
Well, let's hear a story.
Vaguely remember, I was a little younger, but I always had issues with food. I would eat because I would be anxious.
Yep.
And when my dad left, it would get worse. And I would take the lunch my mom gave me, but I will also get the school lunch because I felt like I had to eat it all. And then I love chicken nuggets, still love them to this day.
Who doesn't?
But I would get the chicken nuggets and I would break them into smaller pieces to make more. And my mom, she didn't notice for like months. And then she found out because the school called her and was like, hey, Shayla's eating like two lunches.
I don't mean to laugh, but it's kind of funny the way you tell it.
And she came to me and she was like, why are you eating two lunches? I pack you a lunch and you're going to school and eating lunch. And I was like, well, because I feel like I have to. Mm. Like, I feel like I need to eat. And I'm always hungry. Like, I feel like I'm always wanting to eat.
Interesting.
And so she took that and we talked about it a little bit, and come to find out, now that I look back on it, I was an anxious kid. I was biting my nails. I was eating double lunches. I would always feel anxious, always, and around the time being the new kid or when my dad left, I will always feel like this sense of anxiety. So what my mom did is she started implementing like meal plans at home, and we would have like Taco Tuesday or Lasagna Thursday.
Oh, to make it some kind of like constant.
Yes.
Wow, that's cool.
And then she will also make sure like to tell the school, like, don't give her another lunch. Like, she got this lunch. So when I would come home for dinner, I would get excited because I would knew like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna make lasagna with my mom, because my mom was also a cook for the Army. She would help cook.
Oh, wow, cool.
Yeah. So we would, and my mom, she can throw down in the kitchen. She can throw it down. And so I would get excited because we would make cakes from scratch. We would make lasagna from scratch. We actually made the meals from scratch, from like making pasta from scratch. Like, sometimes we would get store-bought stuff, but I would get excited because I would know I'm spending time with my mom and knowing that I made this meal with her.
Wow.
So it kind of helped me with the anxiety, and then I kind of stopped eating as much, and it helped me with my weight because I was gaining weight, of course, right? Eating like two, three lunches.
Yeah.
Yeah, almost every day. So then I was also being active. So looking back, it was a lot of anxiety that I had built up, but I commend my mom a lot because she did find those ways and did have those conversations with me, but also had those conversations with my dad. So when I did have time to talk to him on the little Skype, I don't know if y'all remember Skype, the little Skype or Uvu, I would talk to him and he would talk to me about it in the desert somewhere and still have those conversations with me as well.
So I commend my parents a lot. I give them a lot of grace now. When I was younger, I didn't really understand a lot
too,
of things.
Me too, man. Getting older changes your views on your own parents, doesn't it?
Yes, because I used to be like, Dad's never here. Like, why he never comes to, like, dance recitals or, like, anything? But he couldn't. He was doing a job. He was serving our country, right? And now that I'm older and I'm also serving, I give my dad a lot of grace, and I see a lot of things from his perspective. And I commend him for doing those things and being able to serve our country and protect our country and then come back and also try to reintegrate himself as being a dad, because he also had to figure out how to be back in that role.
And it probably wasn't easy for him either, coming back to it.
Nope, you're being Sergeant Robinson for all these months, and then you got to come back and try to raise these kids and be a husband and figure out what that looks like. And I'm dual military myself, so sometimes me and my husband were both second classes, so sometimes at home, we'd be second classes to each other.
Yeah, that's right.
And I'll catch it, and I'll be like, hey, babe, like, I don't need HM2 Coleman. I need my husband. So sometimes it's very hard, and it just takes time, and it takes having those open conversations, not only with your kids, but with your spouse as well. I think it's very important to have that open conversation. And I shout out to my husband, because he lets me be very open and vocal. And I tell him, and I'd be like, hey, I see us, we're both working till almost 10 o'clock at night. We haven't spent time together. Like, maybe it's time for a date night. Or, hey, I noticed that we're both being in this kind of petty officer role at work and at home. Like, we need to create a safe space where we're just Chayla and Garius.
Yep.
So having those conversations, I think, are important.
You know, and I have to just thank you for sharing that story and revealing a little person of your personal history, and just highlight how important that story is. Because to me, one of the things that spotlights is something really important we've been talking about, which is that behavior was a form of communication for this kiddo, right? For Chayla when she was little. It was her way of communicating, there's something bothering me, there's some distress. And she probably, and I'm presuming, please correct me if I'm wrong, she probably as a little one didn't even understand it, right? Why she was
what
engaging in this
even
behavior.
Means or,
she says now, looking back, I can see it, right? But she didn't understand what she was feeling or why she was feeling it. She just knew she was engaging in this behavior. And really, kudos to your mom for recognizing that as a form of communication and making some changes. Really, she intervened at home as a way of helping you. You know, sometimes we pathologize that behavior, and we look at it and we say, oh, she's binge eating, right? It must be pathology. And really, sometimes it's communication. At home, mom implemented some structure. Mm-hmm. And she pulled her in a way that improved her connectiveness with her primary caregiver still in the home. Awesome. What a perfect example, a beautiful example of what we've been talking about together today.
Yes, ma'am. I was, like I said, looking back, like, I miss my dad a lot. And even though, like, even looking back now and even now, I miss my family a lot. And there's things that I have to do to still take care of myself and to combat that. And when I do have those low days, bring myself back up and be like, I do have this resiliency. I can continue to do this, right? So, again, I commend my parents. I commend my husband. I commend my mom a lot, because she did have to do some of the two-parent roles a lot of the time. So, yeah, for sure.
And I think what you talked about, I mean, you kind of identified it as anxiety. The things that your mom did that you described would be best practices that we would recommend for all kids.
Wow.
Setting up that predictability, you know, the Taco Tuesdays, that is perfect for many reasons. And when you're thinking about planning for the Homeport shift, really thinking about as a family, what are some things we can keep the same throughout the change? So if you're moving across the country, you know, maybe it's not that, maybe you still can't do tacos because now you're in a hotel and you can't make tacos in the hotel, but setting up something where it could even be like for a real little one, singing them the same song every night. And as you're moving in the hotel, stuff is changing, but you know you have that opportunity to sing that same song. And there's that predictability of what's going to happen. Or maybe it's, you know, Tuesday we cook something together, and there's some flexibility in what that something looks like. I've certainly made meals with my kids in hotels where it was, you know, ramen or sure. my son made my husband a birthday cake 1 year when we were PCSing. It was during COVID, so we couldn't really do a lot, out of vending machine muffins that he like orchestrated nice. And smushed together. And it was beautiful.
That's so cool.
It was beautiful. But it was his way to keep up a routine yep. of Making celebrating the birthday cake because yep. he's my little baker and that's what he does for birthdays. But also we were able to do it in a way that, you know, it doesn't have to look just like it normally does, but you're still giving that predictability. And, you know, it sounds like also, you know, your mom had noticed those things and reached out. You know, Dr. McDonald had pointed out, especially as we get, you know, into, you know, middle school, high school age kids, sometimes it might be hard to see what they are communicating because they're pulling back. And that in and of itself is the communication. So just expecting that and knowing that, you know, the extra sass or the pulling back and not wanting to be a part of the family, that could be a sign that, you know, that's their way of dealing with the change. And so being able to recognize that and setting up opportunities to connect with your kids in a way that it's what they want to do. They have some choice in it. So maybe, you know, your teen really likes playing video games and you're not a video game person, but you're going to sit down beside them and carve out that 10 minutes at the end of the day. And I'm going to sit, you tell me about your video game. You're not telling them how to do it. You're not instructing them. It's just that special time of on their own terms. And I think that can also be another really helpful thing to do as just in general with kids, but especially as we're talking about navigating a big change like a Homeport shift.
Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, ma'am, I agree. I think it's identifying what each of your kids likes and dislikes is. My mom is very good at that, and so is my dad. Like I said, me and my brother is 10 years apart. So I'm 26. He's 16 now. You know, seeing me grow up and becoming this adult, but my parents had to learn that we are two separate people. We are two separate individuals. I'm very extroverted. I'm very out there. I love arts and crafts and being out there. I'm a dancer. My brother, complete opposite. He's introverted. He loves video games. He doesn't really go out much, but he loves riding a bike. Like, if he could, he would sit in a room by himself all day. And so my parents had to figure out when I left the home how to connect with my brother, because I would be the one that would like initiate things like, let's do karaoke, like let's do this, or let's go do some of this, like go out and like watch a movie as a family. So when I left the home and I joined the military, my mom told me she had to figure out what to do to connect with my brother. Mm. Because it was different. I wasn't in the home, and she said it was very hard for her because it was like someone was missing. Right. And so when she figured that out, she actually had a sat down with my brother and asked him just the simple question, what do you like? Like,
yeah,
what do you like to do?
I want to be involved, too.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And my brother would tell her, like, I want to do a lemonade stand and I want to do video game tournaments and I want to get into this stuff. And then once she had to figure it out, she actually took the time to learn what he liked and like listen to him. So my brother had his own lemonade stand that my dad built, and then she would sit in on his gaming tournaments and try to learn and like learn the different games. And then my dad started getting in on it and like buying him the games and like sitting in with him and playing the games with him. So I think having those sit downs with your child and actually getting to know what they like and dislike, and not just guessing, right? Because your kids change, they develop, they change what they like and what they dislike as they grow. So having that sit down and having that conversation with them is important so that you can get kind of attached to them and you can bond with them a little bit more.
So yeah, and on that note, we talked a little bit about, you know, the kind of signs of when it's not going well, and maybe, you know, when it's time to maybe intervene and get some more help. So what does that look like? Once it's like, okay, maybe there's some signs here that that we need some help. What's the next step? And then what does that intervention look like?
Yeah. Okay. So great question. So we kind of talked about that 3 month mark, right? And so we really want to take a peek at, it's really 3 months after that acute stressor has kind of pulled back. So maybe with home port shift, we've moved. Maybe our deploying caregiver has gone and we've kind of gone through that settling in period. We've gotten to some sort of new normal. And after 3 months, these normal adjustment behavioral changes, signs and symptoms that we saw in our kids, those expected changes maybe just aren't remitting. After 3 months, that there are some things that we want to watch for that are really signs that tell us, hey, we need to intervene with our kiddos. So the first one really just goes back to what we were talking about. If we don't see that our kiddos have gone back to what looks like somewhat of their typical functioning.
Some kind of baseline.
Yeah, socially, professionally. So, and that means we mean like in school, right? In the community, if they haven't gone back to somewhere near their baseline. So if they haven't resumed their normal classroom assignments and activities to some degree, if they haven't gone back to the typical emotional presentation that we're used to seeing from them. So some kids have more emotionality than others. But if we see kind of that consistent or continued crying, intense sadness, we call it emotional lability, just lots of big emotional changes that don't seem like they're going back to how our kids typically presented. If we continue to see those signs and symptoms of depression, withdrawal, if they continue to be non-communicative with us, those are some of the signs and symptoms that maybe our kiddo needs the next level of support. One of the other pieces that's really near and dear to my heart that I want to highlight is concentration. We focus a lot on kids' attention and concentration abilities, and concentration can be, especially if it's a change from typical functioning, it can be an indication to us that our kids are still struggling with something underneath the surface. That inability to concentrate, high distractibility, inattention, if that's different than how they had been performing all before this home port shift, and it doesn't return to somewhat of a baseline after about 3 months, that's something that we want to intervene with. Now, I want to talk about some of the more significant ones, and these are ones that we're not going to take the time with. We're going to intervene immediately if we see any of these signs and symptoms, okay? Violent, dark, depressed themes in any of our kiddos' drawings or writings. Really, drawing and writing can be therapeutic. It can be kind of cathartic. It can also be very projective. So a lot of times we see in kids' artwork and their writings what is going on inside. And if we see those consistently dark or violent themes, we want to make sure we intervene with that right away, okay? Anytime we see intentional harm to ourselves or others, that's something we're going to intervene with right away. Anything that becomes a safety concern for our kiddo or anyone around them, we're going to make sure to intervene immediately with that behavior. Self-harm, and especially for our adolescent community, that can be a really scary thing, not just for our adolescent, but also for our parents who are looking at that or starting to notice that behavior. It is not always a suicidal act, but it is certainly a sign of intense distress that we want to intervene with immediately, okay? Significant weight loss, that's a big one we're going to pay attention to right away. Changes in hygiene or taking care of ourselves, our daily routines, brushing our teeth, changing into clean clothes, taking a shower, those sorts of things. And then, of course, any possible signs of drug or alcohol use, we want to intervene in those spaces immediately. The big ones that we always, if you kind of walk away and say, well, gosh, I can't remember all of that, right? The big ones we want parents to remember, or caregivers to remember when they walk away is a change from normal functioning when it comes to emotionality, sleep, mood, or social skills, right? Friends, those areas, or of course, safety, those areas, right. Any really significant ongoing long-term change, we want to make sure to intervene right away.
Sponsor.
And it is, it is really heavy and important stuff. But one of the reasons we talk about it so directly, and I talk about it so openly, right, is because just like we were talking about before, if we don't put this big layer of shame or fear or scariness around these topics, we talk about them openly and honestly with clarity, yep. we can intervene much more quickly. And we know when we intervene quickly, we get the best long-term prognosis, the best positive outcomes.
Right.
So it's okay to talk about these.
Being able to intervene and recognizing those things early, you know, oftentimes that leaves us with, okay, well, what do we do? Like, what is actually available? And we've already talked a little bit about, you know, there are some differences in resources that are available as you're making a Homeport shift. But we have a resident expert on local resources that I think could probably share some things here in Japan.
So, yeah. HM2, let's talk about that. Let's talk about, especially for anyone who's listening who's coming with the Homeport shift. They're going to be new to Yokosuka. So let's talk about some resources that are available.
Absolutely. On base, there is Fleet and Family. They have a bunch of awesome resources. They also run group. They do couples counseling. A lot of people don't know that. They also have financial classes as well. And I think that's very useful. There's also the USO. They do a lot more. They have a movie theater there. They have community service that you can do. We also have our mental health clinic as well, our SARP clinic, right? For mental health, we run groups. We have group therapy on Mondays from 1300 to 1400, and we do CBT, which is cognitive behavioral therapy.
I am a convert. I use a cognitive behavioral therapy and application and therapy to stop drinking alcohol. It changed my life.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
It changed my life.
Absolutely. Yep. You can use cognitive behavioral therapy in a lot of things. The main thing that me, HM2 Chambliss, and HM Chavez usually preach is you can only control what you can control, and teaching people what that looks like, because a lot of people do not know what that looks like. What are the things that are in my control, or what right. are some things that I may have to, you know, let it be or give that control to someone else or figure out the way to deal with it, right? We also have DBT on Thursdays from 8:30.
What's that, DBT?
DBT is dialectical behavioral therapy.
Okay.
And in that, in a nutshell, is learning how to live a life worth living, right? Learning that I want this, but I also want this. But what does it look like to be in this gray area, to live with that, right?
Interesting.
And when I'm in those dark spaces, those dark times, how can I still look at my better days, what my other side, what I want to, what I call the sunshine side, to look like for me, and that I know what that looks like and that I can keep going and I have the capabilities and the strength to pull myself up to get to that other side, to get to that life worth
that
living.
That sounds really cool. I might have to look into that dialectical behavioral therapy.
Dialectical very behavioral therapy.
Cool. And the great thing about those groups is they're very skills focused. So you're going in and you're going to leave the group having learned a skill.
Yes.
And, you know, we're talking about adults here, but a lot of those skills that they're teaching in cognitive behavioral therapy group, or if you were to, you know, seek out individual therapy, a lot of those skills can also be taught to kids. And there's different variations. Right. And so, you know, we talked at the very beginning of this podcast about how important it is to take care of yourself and to model some of that resilience. And the best way to do that is to learn it yourself and then practice it.
Yes.
And then you can, it puts you in a better place to help your kids with these things too.
Yes, absolutely, man. We always tell people that when you come to mental health, we can give you all the skills and tools that you need for your mental health toolbox. But if you never take them out and use them, then they're not going to be really all that helpful. So making sure to take those tools out and apply them to different situations to your life is very important. You have to practice when we talk about mental health. For off-base things, because there's also things that you can do for yourself off-base. I love doing things out in Japan. Everywhere I go, anytime I PCS, I try to find things that is going to better my mental health, right? And I learned that from my mom. Everywhere we went, she found something that was of interest to me and my brother. So one of the things I always love to do is dance. I've been dancing since I can remember. So back in Jacksonville, I was able to find my dance family there. Been dancing for a long time. In Yokosuka, there is is dance studios, opportunities, there is spas, there is onsens. Onsens are very popular out here. And there's all type of food places. Everyone knows that food out here is like the number one thing. There's all places to go to try new things and try new interesting things. And there's all type of things to do in Japan. You just have to find them. And there is the ticket office on base that can actually get you to those opportunities and can give you more information on those things.
I'd also add that Japan's an extremely walkable place.
Yes.
And there are tons of beautiful parks mm-hmm. and beautiful free or very low cost publicly run mm-hmm. beaches, parks, museums, places where you could be outside and like touch a flower and, you know, get outside the skin of the ship and, yeah. you know, yeah, feel the wind on your face.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot of parks. There's a lot of nature that you can go to, a lot of exhibits that you can go to that is free. So not everything you have to pay for, you yep. know, you can do things that are affordable and free for you and your family. And I think that's important to mention, too.
You ladies have given tons of great information. It's really, really a lot of interesting stuff, too. I know you wanted to touch a little bit on some special needs stuff and kind of what parents of special needs child might expect or what their resources look like. So why don't we talk about that before we wrap up?
Yeah, absolutely. And I will say that there is a lot more information in the resources, and definitely encourage folks to use things like EFMP program and other agencies that are able to address special needs more specifically. But I think it is important that we at least, you know, talk about this because, you know, we talked about all children have this, are expected to respond to change. And, you know, there's lots of kind of expected differences in how they're feeling and how they're acting. And what we see is with our children who have special needs, and I'm talking like that's kind of an umbrella, and
of course, right.
Those would be like maybe developmental needs or established emotional diagnoses or differences in the way that kids with differences in how they are thinking about things or who may have trouble with transitions or organizations. Not really throwing out official diagnoses right now because I think it's helpful to more look at what are the skills that maybe my child, I know they have, this is an area of need for them, as opposed to, you know, for all kids with ADHD, you know, these are some things to keep in mind. So, but I think, you know, talking about and being aware of what those specific needs are for your child and what things have worked in the past for them and how can you take those strategies and adapt them to the Homeport shift. So for example, if your kiddo really has a hard time with transitioning, so they're doing one thing and a change in maybe it's something unpredictable happens and their schedule's thrown off. Yep. Or maybe your kiddo just has trouble, you know, they're doing something that they really like and you need to shift to something that is less preferred and they might have trouble with that. Sometimes those difficulties come up with kiddos on the autism spectrum, but lots of kids, you know, anxiety also, you know, can have similar sorts of, children can have similar sorts of reactions. So if that is a known area of concern for your own child, you know, there are things that we can do that are even more important, I think, to do as far as helping kids understand what to expect. So things like social stories. So a social story is basically, you know, you're writing out kind of almost like a little storybook, but the main character in that social story is your child. And
I see.
Yeah. And you could, this doesn't have to be a big elaborate thing, but you're kind of, you're writing out in advance, what are the different things that are going to happen? So, you know, our family is going to pack up the suitcases. So maybe there's a picture of suitcases and then, you know, giving them a sense of, okay, we're, after we do that, then we are going to go to the hotel for X amount of days. And there's a picture of the actual hotel that you're going to, or just a hotel in general, and kind of laying it out like that all the way till when you get there. And that's something that then you can read with your child or have them read, depending upon how old they are, so that they can kind of practice, okay, this is what to expect. And, you know, there could be variations, you know, it's, sometimes things get thrown off of schedule. So you don't want to be too specific with that, but just having those kind of big things so that they're kind of aware of what's going to happen. And another strategy that can often be very helpful is something called a visual schedule. So visual schedules can be used for lots of different things, but it's basically the idea of putting down what that schedule is in some sort of picture reference. So if kids can read, it could be written or it could be pictures of what's going to happen. So kids in school, sometimes we have them, you know, have a visual schedule of first we have reading and then we have snack. And it can really help if you know ahead of time what that schedule is.
I got it.
And so similarly, you can do that for the transition. And also using things like calendars can help kids even have a concept of time. So like it is, you know, sometimes it can be hard for just people in general to really understand, well, what is a month? Like, what does that actually...
Yeah, because it doesn't really exist. We sort of made it up.
Yeah. So what's a month? And and they might be asking questions about, okay, well, you told me we were going to leave in a month, but like, I have no concept of that. I'm five.
All the time. He's like, when are we doing this? And next week, he's like, I don't know what that means.
Yeah, exactly. And so this is especially important for our kiddos who might have difficulties with understanding time and being able to shift and that sort of thing. So actually having a calendar and crossing off, okay, putting a little sticker, this is the day that we go on the airplane, let's cross it off. And it can be something fun to look forward to as you're counting down, almost like some families use like an advent calendar if you celebrate Christmas, where you're like counting down and they know, oh, this is how many boxes I have left.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So those are just some very specific strategies that can be helpful. But for families, again, I could strongly recommend reaching out to the school, because as if you have a child with special needs who has an individualized education plan with the school, the schools are very helpful in helping. They can talk with you about how to transition that plan to the next school.
Okay, got it.
And yep. They might also, the teachers and support staff, you know, things that they're working on in school, if you're not already doing some of those things at home, now is a great time before you leave to talk with your child's support team to understand, you know, what are some things that I could be doing? And just as parents know their child very well, the school team often knows very well. So, yep. You know, I can throw out all sorts of, you know, these are things that tend to work for people, but really I would kind of reference folks back to that, to their teams, so that they can come up with some very specific things that might be helpful. And some of the links that we will be sharing, I think, will have some more specific information too.
Excellent. Excellent. Really good. So this has been one of my favorite episodes I've done in a while. We're talking about some pretty heavy stuff, but everything's been really interesting, and I think it's a lot of really good information. So I'm very, very happy that you all came today to share everything with us. Let's see, before we wrap up, do you guys have any final thoughts you'd like to say to people? Anybody have any final stuff about, I guess what I would like to say and what I kind of have taken from this is, like, you know, If you kind of manage this process as it's going through, maybe you can mitigate some of the sort of more painful parts of it. If you're kind of being open with your kids and knowing what to expect and looking for those things, then it can be a fairly straightforward process, right?
And also just knowing if it ends up not being, like, you could do all the right things and it doesn't go to plan, because that is life. We have resources for that, and there are people to support you. And if you're moving from Japan to somewhere else, there are people there too. And if you're moving here, you know, we've talked about some of those resources. And I think really a big takeaway is to take it one day at a time as well. You know, we can plan as much as we want, and that can be very helpful, but to take each moment as it comes and just try to stay kind of present, and everyone will get through it.
Good advice for life in general, I would say.
Yeah, and as a person who's been through quite a few PCSs and homeport shifts myself, just like HM2 was looking back, I think while the experiences themselves were hard in the moment, the lessons learned and the resiliency that we gain as military families really served us in a lifelong way. And so I think having that positive outlook on, while it can be hard temporarily, the benefits for those kids and those families can be really wonderful. So maintaining that positive outlook for the whole family can be really good too.
Great. Well, on that note, we're going to end like we said. In the show notes will be the links for all the resources and everything that's available. I just want to say thank you to everyone who came today. Y'all were fantastic. And to everyone listening, we will see you next time. Thank you very much.
All right.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. The views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.